So good morning. Welcome to worship this morning. Obviously, again, I'm pre-recording this. We've got a service of communion in Settle Church this morning, so I'm there. But it's lovely to join you online again. It's becoming a bit of a habit, this. I love coming out to places in the Dales to do these services. There's nothing quite like worshipping in God's space. I just think it's the most wonderful thing to do, the most wonderful place to be. And I hope and pray that you'll join with me in worship and in finding God in the places where you are. When I come out, I love to come up. It's something that I personally find really renewing and refreshing, to come high, to look out on the majesty and the beauty of all that God has, and the roads around, you know, where we live, Settle, Ingleton, wherever, are just stunning, aren't they? You know, it's a beautiful landscape, a beautiful part of creation. And I think to come up high and to look down upon it is one of the most lovely things. So look, welcome to worship this morning. A huge thank you to everybody who put so much into our fabulous drive-in church last week. Thank you especially to Bibby's and to Chris and Andy and to Martin as well for all that he did on sound. To the worship band, probably the most unusual gig you've played for a while. But what a fab time we had, didn't we? It was just really lovely, and we were so blessed with the weather, the fact that it wasn't wet, it wasn't windy. I've had to wait and wait to be able to record this service because of the rain and the wind, but I've just picked a bit of a gap in the weather, and it's looking really stunning this afternoon. So so thank you to everybody who really contributed to the drive-in service. I hope we'll do another. I can't promise, but it would be lovely, wouldn't it, to do something. And I'm thinking particularly around carols or Christmas, but we might need to find ways of doing it that, well, if you've got to have your windows closed because there's driving rain or wind, you can still hear and the sound's good. So look, let's get on with our service this morning, and let's just pray as we come together. Loving God, thank you that we can still be your church, your fellowship, despite the fact that we worship in different places. You join us together in the power of your Spirit, in the name of your Son. And so we offer you this time. We lift our hearts to you. We offer you all that we are. And we come to praise you, just because of who you are. So we offer you this time. And we pray that you bless it in the name of Jesus through the power of your Spirit. Amen. Amen. We're going to sing our first hymn. And our theme today is love. The scripture reading for today, the lectionary reading, is the Greatest Commandment from Matthew's Gospel. Jesus talking about loving God and loving neighbour. And so we're going to begin with a hymn that Philip has done for us, which just invites us to build a place, to build a church, to build a fellowship that's grounded and rooted in the love of God and the love of Christ. Let's build a place where love can dwell, where all are welcome in this place. Let's sing together.
Children tell how hearts learn to pour.
What a fab song that is, isn't it? I think it's a fairly new hymn, but I do really, really love it. There's something about it that just invites everybody into the same place. It doesn't matter where we've come from, where we've been, what our background, the colour of our skin, whatever. It just says, you're welcome here with us. Let's worship God together. The sun's just come out and started to blind me, which is a lovely thing. Yeah, so I just think that's a really lovely song. But a couple of other things to mention today. One is, well, firstly, happy birthday, Caroline. I believe it was Friday, your birthday. We missed you as part of our worship group on last Saturday. We hope you've had a good holiday, and we just wish you a really, really happy birthday. A couple of other things I wanted to mention. One is that on the 8th of November, it's Remembrance. Obviously, there'll be a service at St Mary's. We'll be doing something online, and you're very, very welcome to join in with that. But if you'd like to be at the Cenotaph, then there will be a service at St Mary's on the day. Usual social distancing and so on will apply. So please do go along to that if you'd like to. I wondered though if anybody might have anything they'd like to share. We've been asking one or two people in Settle for kind of recollections and memories, or particularly what Remembrance means to you. So it's not necessary that you lived through or survived the war to have a particular memory. It may be that you've got relatives who have been in the forces. It may be that you've got a particular recollection or memory of maybe visiting somewhere. Last year, Pam and I were in Belgium on our walking holiday in Brittany, but we went to Belgium first, and we went to the war graves and to Ypres, and an incredibly moving time for us. And looking for, you know, names on gravestones and walls of remembrance and so on. If remembrance means something to you and you're willing to share it, then please do get in touch. I'd love to come and film you, or just to hear your experiences would be really, really lovely. And the other thing to say, and this is a bit of an advance notice, but on the 22nd of November, I know that feels like forever away. It really isn't in preparation terms. I've got a week off between now and then. So on the 22nd of November, we're going to do another all-age service. I know how much children and families love that all-age, and frankly, I love it too. So look, it's just before Advent starts. We'll be doing other all-age around the Christmas period. But if you would like to be a part of that, if you can contribute to it, if there's something you'd like to do, if you, as a family, would like to do prayers or maybe put a little skit together with some puppets or just as yourselves, it would be really, really lovely. You know, these services are so much better when everybody's a part of them. So if you would like to be a part of that, then please do have a think about it and get in touch, and we'll talk about how we pull that together. So look, I've talked for long enough. Let's pray together. Gracious God, we come before you today to give you thanks. You are a God who is all-inclusive. You don't send us away simply because we're not part of what looks like the religious elite. We're not excluded from your love. You came and sought us in your Son Jesus. You walked the paths of this world to find those who were lost. And you did it because you loved us. And so we thank you, Lord. We offer you all that we are in response to that. We confess to you the many, many times that we fall short. We'd love to be perfect Christians all the time, but I'm afraid that just isn't possible and doesn't happen. And so we pray, Lord, that you forgive us for the sake of your Son, that you renew us in the power and in the life of your Spirit. Make us anew, in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Let's sing again. Let's sing.
song we could ever sing. Worthy of all the praise we could ever bring. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you. Jesus, a name above every other name. Jesus, the only one that could ever save. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you. We live for you. And holy, there is no one like you, there is none beside you. Open up my eyes in wonder and show me who you are and fill me with your heart and lead me in your love to those around me. Jesus, a name above every other name. Jesus, the only one that could ever save. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you.
God, may I build my life on love, on the love of Christ. May that be the foundation for all that I am and all that I do. We're going to pray now for our community, for our family, friends, for our neighbours, for those all around us. Let's pray. Loving God, we pray for our church, for our family, our friends, for our neighbours and for our community. We pray for all those who are struggling at this time, for those who fear what this pandemic will bring, those who worry for their health, those who worry for their jobs, those who worry for their businesses. Loving God, we put our community, our family, our friends, our neighbours, our towns, our villages into your hands. And we pray that you stand alongside us, Lord. Comfort us, be with us. Fill us again with your Spirit. Heal our hearts. Be with all those who struggle, those who worry for money, those whose relationships are breaking down, those who are lonely and afraid. We pray for those in authority. We pray for those who make decisions that affect our whole country. We pray for wisdom. We pray for truth, honesty, humility. God, we pray that you would give them a sense of your Spirit and a sense too of what is right in your sight. We pray for all those who will be hungry this half term. God, may they be comforted in physical ways as well as through our prayers. And may we, as your church, Lord, be empowered to reach out to our communities, to carry not just a word of hope, but a tangible benefit. So God, we pray that you rest upon our nation, upon our communities, and upon our world. We pray for those who are hungry, those who are fleeing war, those who are homeless and refugees, those who seek places of sanctuary. And we pray, Lord, that we might be nations with compassion, bearers of your name, bearers of hope to those most in need. So take away our comfort and help us to be discomforted at the state of this world. Help us to be discomforted at those who are hungry. And shake us to action in your name. Empower us through your Spirit. May we truly be your people, your hands, your feet, your body in this place. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. We're going to sing again. I do hope, as I've said this before, I do hope you sing along. Our worship group and our worship leaders prepare these songs, and I just think they're really, truly lovely. So do, if you can, join in.
To make a wretch his treasure.
So our scripture reading is from Matthew 22. Matthew 22, starting at verse 34. Jesus has just been in conversation with a group of Sadducees about the resurrection. And a group of Pharisees now come to him and they ask him, what is the greatest commandment? Jesus gives one of the most famous answers in scripture, I think. Let's listen to this reading. So this is Matthew chapter 22, starting at verse 34. Hearing that Jesus had silenced the Sadducees, the Pharisees got together. One of them, an expert in the law, tested him with this question. "Teacher," he said, "which is the greatest commandment?" Jesus replied, "Love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your mind. This is the first and the greatest commandment. And the second is like it. Love your neighbour as yourself. All the law and the prophets hang on these commandments." While the Pharisees were gathered together, Jesus asked them, "What do you think about the Messiah? Whose son is he?" "Son of David," they replied. He said to them, "Well, how is it then that David, speaking in the Spirit, calls him Lord? For he says, 'The Lord said to my Lord, sit at my right hand until I put your enemies under your feet.' If then David calls him Lord, how can he be his son?" No one could say a word in reply. And from that day on, no one dared ask him any more questions. Let's pray. Loving God, as we go into your written word, as we explore it, may we come across and find your living word here among us. In Jesus' name, amen. So this is a really interesting part of scripture, and I've preached lots of times before on the greatest commandment, on Jesus being asked about the greatest commandment and telling his followers, love the Lord your God with all your heart, soul, mind and strength. He's quoting Deuteronomy chapter 6, something that really the Jewish people were called to make a part of their lives. Deuteronomy 6 doesn't just tell them what the commandment is, what they've to do, that they've to love God. It says that they're to write it on their doorpost so they don't forget. They're to remember it when they stand up and when they sit down and when they walk and when they eat and when they sleep and wherever they are and whatever they're doing, morning and evening. And they're to teach it to their children. So fundamental is this command, that it's to be passed down through generations, because it defines the identity of the people of Israel. They are the people who've been called by God, whose cry has been heard by God. They are a people who've been identified by God as his, and they identify as the people of God. And Deuteronomy 6 embodies all of that. It embodies not just the hopes of the Jewish nation, but the identity of them as a people. They are the people who love the Lord their God with all their heart, soul, mind and strength. There are people who talk about it, who share it with their children and with generations to come. And the second commandment, Jesus says, is the same as it, is the way that we show and demonstrate that in our earthly life. It's to love our neighbour as ourselves. And there are two parts that I was reminded this week by Inderjit Bogal, who's one of the former president of conference. And Inderjit came and did a talk on behalf of Peer Talk in St John's and Settle on Black Lives Matter and racism and prejudice. And it was a fantastic talk. If you get to see clips of it, I think Peer Talk were going to put it on there. Website, but I thoroughly commend it. It was really, really interesting, and Inderjit's perspective on it I thought was really fascinating. But he talked a little about this commandment too, and one of the things that he reminded us, of course, is that you know, that command says you need to begin by loving yourself, and that's not a selfish thing to do. It's a fundamental foundation of this commandment. It says to love your neighbour as yourself. Well, to do that, we have to know that we ourselves are well and truly loved, and to accept ourselves and to know ourselves as children formed in the image of the living God. It's no good despising ourselves and then loving our neighbour like that. So neighbour love, love for those around us, begins with knowing what love really is, begins with knowing what true self-care looks like. Because how can we know, love our neighbour with the love of God if we don't accept and know the love of God in our own lives too? So first of all, that command says love yourself. Know yourself. Know that you are created and formed in the very image of God, that you are remarkable and unique and special and good, and that God's grace, God's life and God's love is poured out upon you, that God came and sought you when you were lost, and that God's life was given over to you and for you. So let's first of all love ourselves. Let's know what it is to be loved and to love life. And in doing so, we might discover what it means to love our neighbour. So love God first. Love your neighbour as yourself. We're aware, of course, if we go down over the centuries since that command was first given to Moses and the people in the wilderness, that they thoroughly failed, as we fail, in our attempts to be all that God calls us to be. If only we could be more and do more. But there's something else about this passage that struck me this time, it's really only struck me, I think, for the first time this time, and that's this second part. Matthew's Gospel puts these two pieces together, and I'd never seen them as connected before, and even now I wonder if they are. But bear with me for 5 minutes or so as we explore them. This second part of the reading that we heard today, Jesus has just been asked a question by the Pharisees. And while they're there, Jesus turns to them and asks them a question instead. The question that he poses to them is perhaps a bit of an obscure one to us, but not an obscure one to them. They were expecting a Messiah who, in all possible ways, according to the prophets, was the son of David. And that meant something quite specific and particular to the people at the time. If the Messiah was the son of David, then he would assume the kingship of David. He would assume the throne of David. He would re-establish David's kingdom. And in Jesus' time, of course, that meant ridding them of the Roman Empire. It meant starting afresh and anew. It meant re-establishing a kingdom that hadn't been seen or known for, well, frankly, thousands of years. The heyday of the kingship of David was the reign of Solomon, and the riches and the glory of Solomon displayed for all the world to see. You know, we're told in Kings of the Queen of Sheba coming to visit and marvelling at the riches of Solomon, at all that he had, the fortifications he'd built, the palaces that had been made, and so on and so on. The most remarkable things and places, the most incredible wealth. And with that wealth, of course, power. And with that power, of course, prejudice. A desire to protect the power, a desire to protect the wealth and the riches, rather than to share them. And that might be where these two passages are linked. The Pharisees had no answer for Jesus. You see, if they'd said that he was the son of David, then the Messiah that they expect was the one who was going to come to re-establish an earthly throne. He would be subordinate to David. He would be of David's line. David would be his father. Jesus had in mind, though, a very different kind of Messiah, a Messiah that went both on the throne of David, that would be the king of the Jews, the head of the Israelite people, and of course would re-establish them as a great nation. But the remit went so much broader and wider and bigger than that. It wasn't just love for that people, it was love for all people. Love was going to win. Love was going to rule. The great commandment that Jesus talked about, the love the Lord your God with all your heart, soul, mind and strength, love your neighbour as yourself. Jesus goes on to say, on these two commandments hang all the law and the prophets. Well, the law and the prophets, we might say to ourselves, oh, well, everything that was said in the law was summed up in these commandments, or everything that the prophets foretold was foreseen in these commandments. But the law and the prophets in the New Testament is very often a way of talking about the Old Testament. It's a way of talking about the Hebrew scriptures. When they say about the law and the prophets, they're talking about the Torah, which is the first five books of the Old Testament in which the law was written. And the prophetic voices that gave life to that and interpreted it, and that spoke forth God's rule. And so the law and the prophets means Old Testament scripture, in effect. And the whole sweep of Old Testament scripture, the whole story of Old Testament scripture, could be one of two things. It could be the story of a people who God heard, God rescued, who God gave an identity to, who God called out from a place of slavery and made his own, whom he took to a land that he gave them to settle in, and who went into periods of rebellion and exile, but who one day would find their Messiah again and be restored to their rightful place, to their rightful land, and their rightful kingdom re-established. The sweep of the Old Testament then could be the sweep of a story of a people about to be restored. Or it could be a bigger story. It could be a much bigger story, a story that starts in Genesis with the creation of all people, a story that speaks of God's reconciling love and redemption for all of humankind and indeed creation. If that sweeping story is to hang on one thing, then it's that love is greater than any human endeavour, that God is greater than any human kingdom. That the story of the Old Testament isn't simply make Israel great again. It's no great tide of nationalism. It's not tied into the identity of any one people or person. The sweep of the Old Testament, the commandment to love the Lord your God, hung on a tree. It was summed up in the person of Jesus Christ and in his sacrifice. It was summed up in his redemption of those who didn't deserve his redemption, of an outpoured love on a people that weren't deserving of that outpoured love, that had no case to make to be included in the family of God, and yet were included anyway. Whose son is the Messiah? Jesus asked the Pharisees and they had no answer. If they said that he was the son of David, then he would have ended up being subordinate to David, and their expectations of restoration of the kingdom of God would have been limited to a particular people, a particular nation, a particular identity. But if they said that he was God, then they would have had to acknowledge who Jesus was. Because all through the Gospels, the signs, the outpouring of love that God had showed in the person of Jesus had demonstrated precisely and exactly who Jesus was. And what was about to come, what was about to happen, the crucifixion of Jesus, his condemnation to death by these people would have been the greatest act of inhumanity ever perpetrated. So it may be then that these two passages are tied up with one another. The greatest commandment is love, and love conquers all things. There is no make Israel great again, make Britain great again, make any nation in the world great again. There's simply a love outpoured to make humanity God's again. Ah, oh, that's a wonderful thought. And what does God ask of us in that place? What does God ask of us as his people in that kingdom? Morning and evening, getting up, going to bed, walking around, sitting down, eating, sleeping. Love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, and with all your strength. And love your neighbour. Love your neighbour with your heart, soul, mind, and strength. And love your neighbour with your food. Love your neighbour with your words. Love your neighbour with your actions. Love your neighbour with your hands and with your feet. Love your neighbour with your arms outstretched. Love your neighbour as you love yourself. In the name of Christ, amen. Let's pray. God, it's incredible what you have done. That when we were lost, you came and rescued us. And I pray, Lord, that we might build a house where love can dwell, where all can safely live, where skin colour doesn't matter, where sexuality doesn't matter, where age or gender doesn't matter. What matters is that we have enough food to eat, that we respect and love one another, that we treat one another with kindness and with gentleness. God, give us the strength to be your people. In the name of Jesus Christ. Amen. I've got to say, it's turning into the most beautiful afternoon. The sun's coming out, and the sun when it gets low and comes out onto the fells, I just think is the most beautiful, beautiful sight. We're going to sing again. A classic song, I guess, but it just says, you know, our hope is only in one place. Our hope is in Christ alone. Let's sing.
In Christ alone, my hope is found. He is my light, my strength. Faces drought and storm. What heights of love, what depths of peace, when fears are stilled, when striving cease. My comforter, my all in all, here in the love of Christ I stand.
Christ alone, who took on flesh, fullness of God in helpless babe. This gift of love and righteousness, scorned by the wounds he came to save. Till on that cross, as Jesus died, the wrath of God was satisfied. For every sin on him was laid, here in the death of Christ. The world by darkness slain, then bursting forth in glorious day, up from the grave he rose again. And as he stands in victory, sin's curse has lost its grip on me, for I am his and he is mine, bought with the precious blood. Cry to final breath, Jesus commands my destiny. No power of hell, no scheme of man can ever pluck me from his hand, till he returns or calls me home. Here in the power of Christ I'll stand.
It's just the most special song, isn't it? I really, really love that song. The joy of Christ bursting forth and breaking into the darkness of this world is the most wonderful. I was just reflecting on coming up here and what it is about these high places that I really love. And what I was talking about there about the kingdoms of this world, and you know, how God came not to make the kingdoms of this world great places. We're not talking about make Israel great again or make Britain great again. We're talking about the kingdom of God breaking in. As I've come up to here, so I'm looking around, I'm reminded of that place that Jesus was taken to right at the beginning of his ministry. And, you know, he was shown all the kingdoms of the world stretching out below him. And the devil said to him, you know, all these can be yours. You can be the ruler of these kingdoms. Just as perhaps the Messiah, had he been the son of David, had he just taken the throne of David in the way that he might have been. Jesus had other ideas, didn't he? And his idea was a way of love. Most remarkable and amazing way, a way of sacrifice. The greatest commandment in the world, love one another. And so may God bless you this Sunday. May he make his face shine upon you. May he give you the greatest peace of heaven. In the name of Christ, amen.
Of faith and vault of grace, hear the love.